And now, what you've come here to hear, Amos Kennedy.
I'm Leslie Fedorchuk. Hi, everyone. So glad to see so many of you here that I know. Amos has been a force to be reckoned with in the building. He's been printing in the lobby. He's been critiquing. He's been, I hear from my students, making smart remarks in the hallways, all of the above. When they first asked me to do this, I thought I was going to be holding a microphone for people who wanted to ask questions. Then I realized this morning I was going to be sitting on the stage next to him, trying to keep him in check. So what I thought we would do is we'll let him begin speaking, and then I know many of you have questions, and we'll have a discussion until about 7:30. All right?
Well, thank you all for coming tonight, and I'd like to thank MIAD for inviting me for this series. And it's been a delight to be here so far this week, because I do like interacting with students, because especially the freshmen, because you can actually scare them. And there's a certain thrill in scaring young people. I really get a handle on. Yes. What we're going to do is ask questions, but I guess I should talk a little bit about what I do. And that is difficult because I really don't know what I do. I just kind of putz around all day and things happen, kind of. But I have been confronted with this problem a lot recently because people say, well, what exactly do you do, Amos? And I tell them as little as possible. And that is one reason why I moved to Detroit, because Detroit takes a lot less money to live in than other cities in the United States. So I chose a place where I can concentrate my energy more on making stuff than trying to maintain an environment in which to make stuff. And I encourage students to think about that as they go through their work, that where am I going to go? What environment am I going to have so I can make the stuff I want to make? Because that is really what you want to do. You just want to make stuff. And so you have to create that environment. And there's trade-offs that you have to do, and you should start making those trade-offs early. Do I live in New York City and spend all my time trying to live there? Or do I live in the middle of nowhere and spend all my time making stuff? And I can say that I can serve as an example, because I spent 10 years in Alabama, and the largest town I lived in had 1,800 people. The smallest town had 500 people. But it afforded me the opportunity to print without being concerned that much about how much money I made. And so it was good for me, because I honed my skills and I got better at it. I got better at not just making stuff, but I got better at selling stuff. Because after you make it, you have to sell it so you can buy more stuff, so you can make more stuff, so you can sell it, so you can buy more stuff. More stuff, you know, because all you want to do is make stuff. So, you know, it's this vicious cycle of making stuff and getting rid of it so you can make more stuff. Either that or you have a very, very, very large building, you know, about the size of this one, to maintain it all. So I spent about 10 years in Alabama just making stuff, learning how to make stuff, and learning how to sell. One of the things that I have realized as I go around to universities and art schools and talk to the students is that there is this disconnect between art as art and art as the business. And art is a business. There is no one in the United States that is making sable-haired brushes because it is the way to express the angst that they have with the world. And they have a two-page artist statement on it. Everyone who's making sable brushes are making it to sell. So I say that because students sometimes forget that when you buy your sable brush, when you buy your eraser, you are actually purchasing a capital good, because you take that good and you make something of it. You are manufacturers of things, of stuff. You are builders, and you should approach your work as a business at times, How am I going to make a profit? How am I going to buy the things I need? How am I going to pay the rent? So I encourage students to take a business course, a straight up business course, a small business course. Don't worry about that stuff called entrepreneur, because that's a bunch of people go to the small business. You want to take a small business course. You know, if you have an art club here, invite Score in to give a talk about what it takes to make a small business. Because you are a small business. And that is what you want to be. You want to be able to maintain yourself, and you want to be able to make yourself. Then, in addition to that, look at other avenues for selling your work. I know galleries are great, but last night I was sitting up and I said, you know, I'm not represented by any gallery. I've been at this for almost 20 years, 10 in earnest, and I don't have a gallery that represents me. But my work is in the houses of at least 5,000 to 6,000 people, because I sell directly to the people. I sell to the people at a price point that the people can afford. And so I would rather have my work in the house of 6,000 people than in the house of 60 people, because they bought my work at like $1,000 a piece. Because the more people that get your work, the more people that will want your work. The more exposure you have, the more you end up selling. And I know you say, well, you know, I'm not in it for the selling. Well, that's okay. You know, you will as you get over there. And I've done my work in, 600 houses, 6,000 houses. I told students earlier today that, you should have a plan, and that plan is to sell directly to children, because children have the purse strings of their parents. They will buy anything for their children. So aim to make products that a child would like, or a child would appreciate, and then the parent will buy it. Yeah. And that has seriously worked for me, because I sell a lot of things to kids in middle school at art fairs, because they're with their parents and they see a poster and it's $20. And you know, what's $20 to a parent who's already spent $60 on a video game or $120 on a pair of tennis shoes? You know, if the parent is at the craft fair, that shows they have an interest in art. So they want that to be cultivated in their children. And you think about it, if a child can buy a piece of art every year until they're 30, they will have 30 pieces of art in their house. I think that would make them a collector, okay? Yeah. Not only that, it's very seldom that people go out and the first piece of art they purchase costs $5,000 or $6,000. You have to cultivate the market. I tell people that I'm the entry-level drug to buy an art. Okay, that $20 is, but you know, that's the entry level. But you know, so they buy a couple of my pieces and they begin to appreciate it, and then they may spend $50 on a linoleum cut or a small etching. And as they begin to collect, they become interested and they become educated and they start to buy more. And we all know that if somebody comes along that you have sold to in the past and they want to buy a $1,000 piece of artwork and they only have $400, you'll take that $400 and take $100 a month from them until they can pay it off. And so gradually, you know, that $20 that they were spending every year will grow to be like $2,000 or $3,000 a year, because that's what they want to spend their disposable income on. But you have to cultivate that. You have to grow it. And it takes a while. But the wonderful thing is that as you are growing your market, you are growing as an artist too. And so your prices will go up, and the clients that can afford your work at that price will grow too. So cultivate that market. You know, 30 years, that's a lot of art. And then that is just a child of 12, they're just 40. And so they have another good 50 years to buy art. And their real earning potential is just beginning. So you have a true patron. And that's what you want. We want to grow the art market. We We want everybody to be a collector, not somebody. Because everybody has the right. We want everybody to have art in their house, just like they should have books in their houses. Books and art should be mandatory in all homes. Yeah. So this is what I'm about. It's about spreading, I call it the democratization of art, making it available to everybody. And I really don't care if I ever get in a gallery, because there are plenty of artists out there that want to be in the gallery. I'd rather, as I tell the students today, I say, well, once upon a time, I just drive up to a grocery store. I drove up to a grocery store, opened the trunk of my car, and I sold enough posters out of that trunk of my car to buy groceries that week. And that's kind of a cool thing to do, just show up, you know, hey, I'm here with my posters. And people come up and they buy them, and they get excited about it. You know, because they look through and they laugh at some, they think, oh yeah, that's really true, I need to get that for a friend of mine. And it's a delight to see people appreciate your work. It is really exciting, especially, you know, what we consider the common man. Because they do have an appreciation for things of beauty. And we should patronize them so they can patronize us. So I encourage you to think about the democratization of your art, of making something available to someone that can only afford $20. That is something that you should shoot for, because it's easy to make something that costs, you know, $10,000. And all you gotta do is put a price on it. Somebody comes along and says, yeah, it's worth it. And they buy it. What is his name? Thomas Kincaid showed you. You can sell junk for a lot of money. You know? So it's good. But can you sell something really good for a little money? That's a little bit harder. But it's worth it. The reward of making someone happy is sometimes worth more than the money you get from it. And I, you know, that's what I truly believe. So that's what I'm about, and you know, I'm also about trying to remind people that life is too short not to be happy. Okay? And it's your responsibility to be happy all the time. No, not summertime, all the time. Just appreciate it and just go skipping down the street. You know, that's okay if people think there's something a little wrong with you. Because there's something a little wrong with them if they don't want to skip down the street. They got to hang up and they need to get over it. And so why should their hang up stop you from being happy? So it's your responsibility to be happy. As I was talking to the students, to the people who make stuff in there, you ever get to that point where you get giddy and you're making stuff? You're like, oh my God, this is so much fun, I want to do that. You know? Yeah, that's the experience you always want. And not only that, you want other people to have that experience. Just be excited and happy in the process of making things. I once thought that art was really making stuff. You know, the process of making stuff. And the product was just, you know, that was just the end product of it. But it was the experience that you went through to make something that was really the art. And that poster is just like, oh, proof that you went through the process. You know, it's that, I just thought it was that personal thing. But then I realized that I have people that get really excited when they see it. And so it's that excitement, it's that happiness that you get and that you can share through the things you make that I think art is. And I have an issue with art, and I will address that now. Yes, I'm an old man, and I am cranky. As a matter of fact, there are a few people in here with letterpress, but I did a poster last year that said letterpress is a noun, not a verb. And that's because it's being used as a verb by this new generation of printers, and I just like, no, we don't do that. It's a noun. You don't letterpress. I'm going to go letterpress something. No. You know? So, yeah. And what was I talking about? This is our problem with getting older, just remember. Oh, yeah. Crunkiness and happiness and art. Yeah, so I don't believe in art. I believe in making things and making stuff. And I repeat this over and over again. I think that it is the making that is the important thing. I really like the word craft, but a couple of weeks ago I thought craft was too elitist, and so I just started. I also didn't think I was a really good printer, so I started telling people I just sling ink. And so, you know, and that is about what I do, I sling ink around. But I think that we have a tendency to look down upon the crafts, but the crafts are the basis on which art has risen. And that we should celebrate crafts people. Because actually, again, it's the doing, it's the making that we really enjoy. And that is what craft is about, doing and making things. And a person who does high craft makes things of great beauty that also have utilitarian use to it. And why not decorate your house with a handmade chair as opposed to one of 15,000 IKEA chairs? You know, so, you know, again, patronize the crafts, patronize the arts, rather than buying something from a big box store. Well, you say, Amos, it costs more. And I say, yes, it does. But how often do you buy a dining room table? Every 3 years? No, you buy one and you keep it for the rest of your life unless somebody breaks it. Which is great. However, if you have teenage boys, it will happen. Okay? So you say, well, that's a lot of money. Yeah, it's a lot of money if you think about it as that one-time purchase. But if you say, I'm gonna have this for 30 years and it costs, you know, $3,000, that's $100 a year. I can't even get coffee for that much. You know? But you know, I think a lot of people don't think that way. And basically, you don't throw a lot. When you buy things of quality, you don't throw them away. You keep them. What you throw away is junk. Don't buy something because it's cheap. Buy it because it is exquisite. It may cost a little more, but it's going to last a lot longer and bring you far more satisfaction. I read an essay where somebody talked about, and this like completely messed my mind up for a long time. Because I had taken economics, and in economics there's this issue of diminishing return on investments, and you know, but he said that there's a diminishing return on consumerism. Like the first chair you buy brings you a degree of happiness and satisfaction that is like really, you know, monumental. But when you buy your 100th chair, you don't get that same thrill. It's like, I just got 100 chairs, that's all. So, you know, that consumerism diminishes. The satisfaction you get from it diminishes. So don't get caught up in that. Buy one or two things of quality that will last you. And most of the time, things of quality are handmade by artists and artisans that populate this nation everywhere. So go out and seek them, purchase from them. If you're an artist, trade with them. But keep that alive, because the more it grows, the bigger it will get. And I think that the more it grows, the more the general population will begin to purchase. But we have to start somewhere, and the place to start is here. There's a Chinese proverb, the best time to plant a tree was 20 years ago. The second best time is now. Now is the best time for you, students of this institution, to go out and engage with the general public, to educate them about what you do, and to give them appreciation so they can support you. Okay? That's for the students.
This discussion. Who has a question for Amos?
Yes.
Madeline.
We're obviously really interested in coffee.
Yes.
And we have all different points of view about coffee, so I'd like to hear the genesis of that and the story behind that.
Well, the genesis of that is simply that I have to pay my rent. And coffee is something a lot of people like. Actually, the first coffee poster I did was Coffee Make You Black. And that is an old saying in the South that was supposed to keep children coffee, because when I grew up, the last thing you wanted to be was black. However, my mother had a friend, and she was over for coffee, and my mother offered her a cup of coffee, and she said, "Oh, Helen, don't you know coffee makes you black?" I said, "Make that two cups." And this woman was very, the darker the berry, the sweeter the juice. You know? So that's where it began. And then I found out, because I listened to my public, and so I found out that they wanted to have more coffee posters. And as a matter of fact, I had the Coffee Make You Black poster, and a man from Mobile went through and said, "Oh my God, if this said coffee makes you gay, I would buy it for my friend." And I said, "Oh, okay." And I said, "Well, wait a minute, let me just cover all bases." And so I did Coffee Makes You Queer. And right now, Coffee Makes You Queer is one of my best sellers. And two stories about that is that, one, so I do these outside craft fairs, and I was at one, and this woman in her about her 50s comes up with her mother, who was like in the late 70s or early 80s, and they're looking through the pile, and the woman picks up the Coffee Makes You Queer, no, Coffee Makes You Gay, and she said, Mom, you think I should buy this for Richard?" And the mother looked up and said, "Oh dear, everybody in town knows he's gay, including him." You know? And so they purchased it. The other is, I had two little boys that came in and they purchased Coffee Makes You Gay and Coffee Makes You Queer. And they were like 12. And I said, "Well, what are you gonna do with these?" And I said, "Oh, we're gonna give them to our teacher." And the way they said it, I knew there was no malice in it. You know, like, oh, yeah, he'll get a kick out of this. And so I said, "Okay." And so they went away, and about 15 minutes later, I see this woman walking to my area. She has great determination on her face, and she just walks in. She looks around. I kind of watch her out the corner of my eye. She walks around. She looks at everything. And then she finally walks up to me, and she says, "I see you have a Coffee Makes You Queer and a Coffee Makes You Black poster. What exactly are you trying to say with those?" I'm trying to say that if it wasn't for coffee, I'd be a white, straight guy. Yeah, but she didn't laugh. Seriously, everybody else that heard it just cracked up. She was like, and then she popped. You know, what is happening that, you know, people can't take a joke? You know, it's like, wait a minute, you know, like, what has gone wrong here? You know, everyone in the South and knows Coffee Makes You Black is something that has been said, and it's said not with any malice, it's just that it's become part of the culture. So yeah, that's why I do coffee.
All right, anybody else?
Maybe coffee made her insane.
Yeah.
Laugh at all. Yes.
Yes. I have a question. Just, what are some of the things that inspire you to continue doing art? Like you said, you're a grown man, and you know you've seen a lot of things. like, what inspired you to say, like, "Hey, I want to keep on doing this. I want to, you know, get my art out there."
Well, the things that inspire me, first and foremost, is my rent. And after that, I need my electricity, I need my automobile insurance, I need to have my big gas. These are the things that inspire me on a daily basis to get up and make art. Okay? And because, well, I had this conversation with some students, because I think that one of the myths, there's two myths that I want to dispel about artists. The first one is, starving artist. A starving artist is a bad artist. That's what a starving artist is. Period. End of discussion. No more remarks. Just like a starving mechanic is a bad mechanic. It isn't like, "Oh, the world doesn't understand me." No. Okay? The second is like, I am waiting for that moment of inspiration, because I can only create through that moment of inspiration. You create by creating. If you want moments of inspiration, they come through hard work. Not hard work, they come through discipline work. Every day you get up. Because I will tell you, I get into it, I get in the moment, and like I said, I get giddy. I can say, well, that's my moment. I'm in my moment of inspiration because I'm just dancing around and having fun. Oh, that's awesome. You know, I'm on the DVD, on the documentary, one of the young men said, well, you know, like Amos must really like this because like at 2 o'clock in the morning, he said, damn, I love the print. And that is exactly what I do sometimes. I just scream, damn. This is good stuff, you know? You know? You know? So, yeah, you know, you get inspired, but you don't wait for the moment. Make the moment happen. Through doing work, you become inspired, you know, by doing it, you know. And you think about your moment, you know, like, oh, I got a moment of inspiration, now let me go. It's like you're working and you get inspired. And sometimes it is something full of energy and burst like the sun, and other times it's something gentle and quiet where you are just there. Sometimes I can be sewing books and I just sit there and just the sound of the thread as it moves is the only thing that I listen to. But it's just beautiful to be in that moment. So by doing it again and again, it's one of these things like you can make yourself as high as you want, you know, just by doing it. And so you do it. And that's why I encourage people to find a place where you don't have to spend your time maintaining the environment to create, but you can spend your time creating. You know, yeah. In the middle of nowhere, I don't want to be there. No, I want to make stuff. So I will be in the middle of nowhere so I can make stuff. Because if I make stuff long enough and hard enough, people will discover me. And if your work speaks volumes, you don't have to say anything. Because you do have industrial design here, and it is such an important part of it, that it does rub off that whole, you know, like, I'm going to get a job and I get out of here with, you know, GM or Parker or something. So people know that they can leave and actually work.
And they make stuff.
What's that?
Our industrial designers make stuff.
Yes, they make stuff.
They make stuff.
Yes,
so,
they do.
You know.
Absolutely.
I think it's a really good point. Where's Kyle? Kyle, where are you?
He's not here.
He was here before. I really like to hear one of the students speak to that? Do you think you're given adequate information about getting out of here? Is it a surprise? Do you think you're elevated to this platform where you're encouraged only to make high art? Or, you know, what's the feeling you have?
I think we're all encouraged to go to different routes depending on a major or what we're feeling for. And those students who went straight for jobs right out of school and are working to survive or have moved and are working to live. And I know students who have stayed, you know, in the middle of nowhere so that they made their art. So I've seen a lot of variety, and I think depending on what you want, MIAD does prepare you to achieve that.
Yeah, I think the key there is depending on what you want. And I think the party line here, if I had to speak to it, and I will, why not, is what's right for you. What do you need? Where do you want to be when you leave here? And then how can we help you get there? Somebody else have a question? True. Emily?
So I'm wondering, like, with the specific craft that you do, especially with printing, I know, like, artists who usually actively be practicing when they're doing, like, I'm an illustrator, I practice around people because I want to get better at it. I'm just wondering if, like, you actively practice what you're doing to get better, or if you just kind of get better over time, and that's just like you're doing what you do until you get better.
Well, one, you always get better with time, okay? That's just a good thing about it, because you get rid of the youth, and youth is really highly overrated other than for the health. You know? So you actually do get better with time. And yes, I do practice. I practice all the time. I like to, you know, I tell students, set your expectations really low, because you meet them, and then as you meet them, your confidence grows and you make them a little higher. So I have an expectation to put ink on paper every day I'm in my shop. And that can be printing a poster to the simple act of inking up a brayer and making a mark across a sheet of paper. But I have to do that. Low expectations are easy to meet sometimes. And then I may roll that and it may say, wow, that looks kind of cool. What if I roll it this way? And the next thing I know, I was leaving at 6 o'clock, but I'm still there to 8 because I've gotten involved in the process, you know, because I have this, I gotta put ink on paper every day. So you have to practice every day. And wait, oh yeah, I got this, okay. I forgot that we're gonna have a question and answer. I was gonna just do it myself with flashcards. Okay, so I have this one. Practice makes perfect, but perfect practice makes perfect perfect. So you practice not just to be perfect, but you do perfect practice. And perfect practice is almost taking what you do and turning it into a ritual. You know, then the best example I can give to that is the Japanese tea ritual. You know, where there's a formal protocol that you go through. And you can create that yourself. Okay, and in conjunction to that, there is perfect practice leads to perfection. You know, same thing. And that is again over time. You know, so it's over time and practicing. That's what makes it. You know, you make more stuff. Someone said, I think someone asked me, how do you sell your work? And I said, you sell your work by selling it. You know, it's just that simple. The way you do something is by doing it. I mean, it sounds like, you know, like, over my Nike ad, but you know, Nike actually stole that from Donald Jackson. Donald Jackson is a calligrapher out of England. At one time he was the calligrapher for the Queen of England, and a member of the Royal Society of Scribes and all the rest of that. But he said it is through the doing that you perfect yourself. As a novice or amateur, the mark is not what you want. But the more you practice, the better you get at it, the more the mark becomes what you see. Because one of the things we do, and I have to talk to that too, one of the things we do is that we have something in our head. We take you know, an image and transfer it to the physical world. It's like alchemistry or something. We have an image in our head and we want to transfer it to the world. That's really cool. And the other thing I want to mention is that, you know, it is time for us to recognize not what makes us different, but what makes us common. And it's time for us as artists to embrace the sciences and say, we forgive you for being who you are. And we're gonna let you back into the fold. And the reason I say this is, one, I was at a meeting where I found out that the NSF has funding for arts, and they are actively recruiting artists for projects and partnering on projects that they are, you know, that they fund. And one of the things that they have, and this is exclusively for artists, is they have a residency in Antarctica for 2 to 3 months that you go down and you make art. Now they don't pay you anything, but they fly you down there, they feed you, and they put you up. And how much money can you spend in Antarctica? You know? So, you know, but that's in, you know, that's in the sciences. And you have to realize, and when I say that we have more in common than we have in different, you know, artists, you know, mathematicians, physicists, biologists, all deal in creativity. Accountants, lawyers, all deal in creativity. Engineers are creative people. We are all creative people. Instead of us trying to figure out why we differ in our creativity, why don't we embrace creativity and say we are all the same? You know, we're all the same, we just do it different.
Somebody else?
Yes. Two questions, actually. That being said, do you ever collaborate with a mathematician, scientist, or any other artist to do your work? And then my second question is, can you kind of walk us all through, like, your thought process when you start having inspiration? Like, and does it come, sometimes come a little bit later, or does it come over a period of time, or
I haven't collaborated with many people. I collaborate with a lot of people. And the collaborations are really good. This summer I collaborated with one of my neighbors to help build a wood-fired pizza oven. You know? And it paid you last year. Really good. Okay? All right. And we are the only community wood-fired pizza oven probably in the United States of America. You know? And so, and then I collaborate with other people. I don't really collaborate. I don't collaborate and I don't do internships. And people say, why don't you? And I don't hire people. No one works for me. Because if someone works for me, then I really have to actually make money. And that would spoil it, you know. But what I do is that I open the doors of my shop to anybody who's interested. And you come in and I give you the fundamentals. And then you can start to make posters. And you can do this for as long as you want, as long as you don't make more money than me. But when you start to make more money than me, we have to have a conversation. But most people do it for like maybe 4 or 5 weeks. But one day I'm meeting somebody who's going to actually stick it out and really like it. Because one of the things that I realized when I was in graduate school is that most of the time people, and this is something for the students out there, this is absolutely, when you leave here, you ain't gonna have what you got. Unless you're, how many trust fund babies do we have in the room? Okay, if you're not a trust fund baby, you know the woodworking shop, the 3D lab you have downstairs, you're not gonna have that anyplace else. So take advantage of it, all that you can. You know, take advantage of it, because you're not gonna have it. If you're a printmaker, unless you have like, $3,000 to $4,000 to purchase a small printing press, you won't have access to a printing press. So it was like, well, I was told to do one assignment. I don't want to do that one. But you should do like as many prints as you can. It should be like, when can I get on the press? Because that guy is hogging. You know? It's like, well, maybe we need to buy more presses because, you know, there's a backlog in the hallway. In all seriousness, you need to do that because it's not there. And that's why I open up my shop, because some people get addicted to letterpress and then they get out. And right now, a Vandercook runs somewhere around $5,000 to $6,000 and they don't have that. So what are they going to do? Somebody has to say, come on, you can do it here. Come on, you want to be a printer? I don't want you to say, I wanted to be a printer, but I couldn't find any place to do it. Hey, if you want to come to Detroit, come print. You know? That's the attitude. That's the collaboration I do. How do I work? Well, as I told students today, you know, about 60% of art is actually research. And the rest is kind of making stuff. So I spend a lot of time reading and finding topics that I'm interested in. And then once I find that, I get a body of aphorisms or proverbs. And once I have that body, then I have to edit the ones that I want. And then I go about printing. And the interesting thing is, and this all goes back all to practice and doing stuff and becoming familiar. When I first started doing posters, I just put words in the background kind of related to the subject. But now I put words in the background that I have researched and really emphasized the topic. So I will have in the background, say, cities and countries that have a great importance in coffee. Dates where coffee was introduced, so say Europe, to the new colonies. And so now suddenly my backgrounds are more informative. And although no one may never read them, you know, it just is satisfying to me. So as you do things, you hone them, you get better at them, and then you really begin to be able to take that image in your mind and bring it to the real world.
Yes, Zoe.
I love coffee.
Mm-hmm.
I love coffee. All I can do is my to go home, but and I love when I walked in and I first saw all your prints up. Walking into the building, I was just delighted. The color and the aesthetic is vibrant. But there's also, besides the coffee and things that make people chuckle, there's some political stuff going on there. There's not so much hung up. I've seen more political stuff done by you, you know, outside of what's being hung up. But I want to talk about posters and other projects that you've worked on. And besides,
I deal with a lot of subject matters. One of my favorite subject matter, and this goes back to when I started printing, and I started printing in about 1998. And so I took this class in Chicago, and it was a, you know, adult enrichment sort of course. And I was a math major, and so in this class, the woman who taught it, Pam Berry, was an English major, and there were these people always talking about these poets, you know, and I'm like, whoa, you know, poets this, poets that, and I'm like, oh, I just felt like a little intimidated. And then driving home, and they said, well, I know poets, I know Langston Hughes, I know Georgia Douglas Johnson, I know Paul Lawrence Dunbar, I know poets, but they don't know those poets. And then I looked and I said, wait a minute, in this area of fine print, the voice of the Negro people, and that's why I call myself, I'm a Negro, I know I look like an African American. It's a distinction that some people can't make, but I am that. You know, the voice of the Negro people were missing. And so I initially started out to make things specifically to fill that void. And I did that for a few years. And then I realized that that was kind of narrow and that it was better to expand. But I still do a lot of political stuff. I did, in the 90s, I did a whole series of posters because I was unaware of it until the Tribune did an article 1 January, but I think it was in 1994, something like 60 children under the age of 15 were murdered in Chicago. That's a lot of people to be murdered. And we talked, I was like, you know, if he's 16, 17, he gets shot in a gang war, that's just common. But when you're 3 and 2 and you're beaten to death or you're starved to death, that's perverted. But we had this society where children under the age of 15 could and were being murdered and nobody was seriously addressing it. And so for 3 years I did a series of panels dedicated to that. And it got really depressing because the numbers kept going up. It didn't go down. And I said, we can throw away human life. This is, you know, waste is a sign of extreme wealth. And we are an extremely wealthy nation that can throw away human lives. The most precious of all things, according to some people, we can waste. Why does a 4-year-old child have to be murdered? Why do we have to have an environment that will allow that to happen? So I kind of refocused myself because I realized that as a stuff maker, one of the things I do is I want to create stuff to create the environment that I want. So everything I do is political. This is why when you go downstairs, there's a whole series of posters on kindness. Is kindness a political thing? No, it's a human thing. So I kind of moved beyond politics. And one of my great things about the difference between politics and humanness is, you know, the saying politically correct, which has been co-opted to be this negative thing, oh, you're being so politically correct. And I love it when people charge me with political correctness because my response is, when you say politically correct, do you mean like in owning other human beings like it was politically correct? Do you mean like politically correct and not allowing women to vote like that was politically correct? What kind of political correctness are you talking about? Because all those things were politically correct at one time. Politics has nothing to do with morality. Politics has nothing to do with the betterment of humanity. Therefore, I've kind of moved to what is kindness? That is something that we all understand and we all want. We want people to be kind to us. We want to be kind to people. And so I've moved to that level. And it's kind of subversive in a way. I'm kind of like, well, maybe if they put this up in their cubicle, they'd be a little kinder. Now, one of them says, make haste to be kind. Well, make haste to be kind. Be kind to yourself, because being kind to yourself is the foundation to being kind to others. I mean, like really, if you're happy, aren't you happy with other people when you're happy with yourself? When you're kind and gentle with yourself, aren't you kind and gentle with other people and understanding? So I've kind of moved from the politics of this university. It's an old age thing.
Stand up, Laura Zinger. And she's the director of the documentary.
It wouldn't be that great if you wasn't in it.
It would have been much better if she had listened to me. this artist and thing, why don't do that? Well, because the artists charge a lot of money, okay? I mean, seriously, I had an artist to come to my studio for about a year, and he produced a body of work, you know, some wood type in the press bed, some ink on chipboard, and he went to New York City, and he was selling, and he sold them each at $425 a piece. That's art. Okay? You know, I got a piece of chipboard here. I got, you know, like 30 minutes of setting up. I got like maybe a dollar worth of ink, and I can sell that sucker for $425. That is an art. Okay? Because I have a hard time getting, you know, for the big ones, like $20, you know? And so, yeah, that's what art is. Art is being able to sell stuff for far more than it's worth. You know, seriously. I had a friend who did a show in the gallery, and I was like, oh, congratulations on your show in this gallery. And she said, Amos, you know, I can't even afford my stuff. And I'm saying, well, why are you there then? You know, you should be someplace where you can afford your stuff. I mean, if you can't buy your stuff, you know, there's something is wrong. And that's one reason why galleries won't care. You know, like, you want me to sell a $20 poster? Are you kidding? And I like to relate the story. I have a friend in Italy, and he appears in the movie, Alberto Casaraghi. And he's been making these little books for almost 20 years. And when he started, he makes these little books one a day, about an edition of 20. And he sells them for the equivalent of about $10, $15. And when he started, he went to a bunch of big artists, you know, printmakers, and said, would you do a series of prints for me, and this is what I'm gonna do? And they kind of laughed at him. And he said, you kidding? My prints sell for, you know, $200, $300. You want me to do this? And so he went away, and he just kept making these books. And now those same printmakers come knocking on his door saying, excuse me, could you find time to make a book with my prints in them? Because he still doesn't charge. You know, he still charges $15. And I had him in Indiana, and one guy went around and ticked off all the big printmakers from Italy, and that's all the books he bought. And I think he probably tore the print out and threw the book away. But Alberto doesn't care, you know. I'm making these books for the public. And so that's what, you know, that's not, you know, that's the difference, you know, like artists make, I think that people should make things that they can afford. And the general public. Oh yeah, you can make things for $6,000-$7,000, but you should have something for, you know, every man or every woman to be politically correct.
Somebody else. Yes.
Yeah, I guess I was just wondering, fronting your own business, what was the biggest challenge that you had kind of starting your own thing up? What would you?
Well, there are a lot of challenges in starting your own thing up. And like one that will haunt you is getting rid of the client from hell. But you have to have one or two in order to appreciate their absence. Okay? I mean, you get a client that just, no matter what you do, they just give you a hard time. And it's part of the process of just becoming a business person. And at some point you can look and you can say, when they walk through the door or when you pick up the phone, thank you very much, but I'm busy right now. And so that's one of the big things. The other things is keeping your books, because you'd be amazed at how many little sheets of paper you get in the course of a week. You know, a receipt here, a receipt there. And again, like I said, you know, you run off to the art store and you buy, you know, a couple of pads of paper and a pencil, and you know, it comes like $10. You say, well, I'll just throw that away. No, that's a business expense, so you have to keep the receipt. Because at the end of the year, when you do your taxes, all that goes against all the money you didn't make, you know? So that is the big thing. You know, and it's just that, and also that, you know, that you have to do, you know, separate time, and you have to realize that at some point, I have to hire professionals. I can't do it myself. Because what I want to do is make stuff. I don't want to, you know, do my income tax. I want to make stuff. So I'll hire somebody else to do the things I don't want to do so I can do the things that I love to do.
Okay, this directly relates to that. So I really like to hear you saying about discipline of making your art and like the art of making things and continuing your practice and being like your main focus. But how do you balance that and research and family and social engagements and like everything else that you're doing on, like interacting with the community and meeting things?
Just do it. Again, it's something that you just, it's a talent you, you know, it's that you develop over time. And you realize that, hey, I have to spend some time in my community doing this. And it also helps when your children get grown, okay? It's considerable. You'd be amazed at how much free time you have after your child actually learns to drive and you trust them with the car. Are they completely grown and out of the house? That helps considerably. But it's one of those things that you don't balance it correctly at first, but as you do it more and more, it becomes almost seamless. How do you do that? I mean, I watched a guy who's a sculptor in Detroit build a 250 square foot small studio by himself in about a month. And all he had was a foundation down. And it's a shed type building, and the highest peak is 18 feet. But he did it by himself. And you go inside because it's just frames, not drywall or anything. And he has all these beautiful old 2x6s that he got from buildings around Detroit. And I'm like, how did he do that? Like, I haven't done anything this month. But then somebody said, yeah, he just printed like 8,000 posters last weekend. I said, yeah, but that's nothing, He built a whole building. and it's like you just begin to do those things. It's all practice, In 5 years, you begin to balance things. It gets hectic, and you're like, I don't want to do this, so I'm going to drop it. But you just kind of keep it up. Again, as I told the students, you don't fail, you learn. So you just keep doing it, and the more you do it, the better you get at it, and you can balance. And so that's why I tell people, I really don't do anything. I just kind of putz around. But I do manage to pay all my bills and, do all the things that are required by the government in order to be here.
Anyone else? Morgan.
I just go do something else. I got enough things on my plate that, I can go do something else. And you do get stuck. I do this little thing, and I have no idea why I do it. I take a book and I fold it, and I make these, they call them doorstops. And I just fold paper and, just do that. And, I get to a point where I can't work on them anymore. And so they just, they are there, like, three-fourths being complete. And it just sits there for a long time, and then suddenly I just sit down and I do it, And sometimes it is that there is, this convergence of time and energy that just makes things right. And so that's what happens. I have a project that I should have finished several months ago that I have not finished. But right now, as soon as I get back to Detroit, I've been working on it before I came here, and I'm just going to continue. It's like now I've just got all this energy, and I just want to do it. But I don't say I'm stuck and I'm through it. It's like, oh, I got something else to do. And so you have a lot of things going on, and it could be unrelated. I'm making I'm saving all my old pink shirts because I'm going to make a bunch of pink quilts. And so now I'm saving them, and one day I'm going to take them all out, and I'm going to cut them into 4-inch squares. And that's the other thing. A lot of things, big projects are just simple, small projects that you build on. And so sometimes you just, again, keep the expectations low. I don't want to build the quilt today. What I want to do is cut all the squares. So I cut all the squares, and it may rest for a while. It may breathe. And then the next day I may say I start sewing it. And I may sew a fourth of it. Say I'm going to sew another fourth the next day. So it's always breaking things down into manageable bites.
That was a question in class today. How many pink shirts do you think he actually has?
I can tell you exactly. I have 36. I buy them by the dozen.
You had a question? What's the end?
So you gained quite a reputation as you've been here. You know, teasing students, particular.
This isn't about you. It's me, I'm here, it's not about you. It's about me.
We were talking and...
We? Someone talks to you?
I do.
Oh, okay.
But we were talking about how you kind of gain this recognition in the school. If people don't know your name, they're going to be like, oh, you know Amos?
Who?
The guy with overalls. Oh, right. So we were asking, and I am particularly curious, and I hope everybody else is too, how many pairs of overalls do you own? And what's the story behind them? Why always overalls? Why not overalls
tonight? I have an overalls tonight. I wore overalls to his funeral. I'm like, hey, he didn't say a word. how many pair of overalls? Okay, here's the thing with overalls. Number one, this goes back to years ago. So I was working, I was employed with AT&T. There's a difference between work and employment, but I won't go there. I was employed with AT&T, and I was in downtown Chicago, and I was on the west side. And then in between me and the lake, there was the business section with all the finance. And right next to the lake was the School of the Art Institute. And so I stayed over on that side, but I would go and visit a bookstore over by the School of the Art Institute. So everybody over there at that time was in blue or gray suits, white shirts, striped ties. And the women were wearing blue or gray skirt suits with a big bow. And so, you know, that was it. Everybody dressed like that. And then I went one day to this bookstore, and as I approached the bookstore, there were all these people standing on the corner. And as I got closer, I noticed that they were all dressed in black, smoking Camel cigarettes. And someone said, well, there was a fire drill, and the School of Art Institute. And I said, oh my God, artists wear uniforms too. It's called black. You know? And so I realized everybody wears a uniform. And so this is just my uniform. It's one less thing I have to think about in the morning, a pink shirt and overalls. But back to the overalls question, what happens is every 3 years, I buy three pair of overalls. Those become my overalls like these. See how new these look? Because I just bought these last year. And then the pair that I had previously, let's just call that my A brand, okay? Then the A's become the B. And the B's are like, oh, I can wear that to a business meeting, or to a conference, or something like that. And my B's become my C's, which I wear to work, and I get dirty, and I just get grubby. And then again, in 2 years, I do that again. And so I just keep shifting. So I have about 9 pair of overalls. I just shift through.
We have time for one more question. Yes.
Was there a particular moment or person that inspired you to start making stuff?
I got inspired. I used to try to do calligraphy, but that was not a no-go for me. But letterpress printing in particular, I went to Williamsburg and I saw it there and it just connected with me. And then when I got back to Chicago, I found a place to learn how to do letterpress printing. And it was just great. And I was there for a while working with the people. It was great camaraderie and everything. And then one of the women that I learned how to print went out and bought herself a Vandercook for the whole sum of $500. And I'm like, God, I wish I had $500. I could buy one. And then the next week, one of the people said, hey, there's a notice on the board for a free press. And so I called, and it was a Vandercook, just like the woman had spent $500 on. So I got my first press for free. Well, not really for free, because I had to move it. And that was like $200. And then after that, about 4 or 5 months later, I met these old printers, and I was telling one of them I wanted to teach my sons how to print. And he said, well, come by my house because I have this little, it's called a job stick that they use to in printing. I have a small one that's really great for kids. And so I go by his house, and we go into his basement, and he shows me his type collection and everything. And then he hands me the stick, and as I'm leaving, he said, would you like to have my stuff? And I said, yeah. And here I had a complete stranger who just on a whim, I have no reason why, said, you know, just gifted me this. And at that point, you know, it kind of dawned on me that, you know, I need to be doing this more. And that's another reason why I try to give back, because these old printers were so generous. You know, generosity is what makes us human. We have to be generous. Oh yeah, go ahead, this is a really cool. Oh no. Oh, my. George Washington Carver was?
Peanut butter.
So anyway, this is from the man that we all know as the Peanut Man. And he had a list that he taught at Tuskegee Agriculture, so he had young men that were always surrounding him and kind of following him because he was like a cool person. But so he made a list of things that they should always do. And one of them was, be too generous to cheat. Isn't that great?
Yeah.
Another one was, be too brave to lie. And so I have printed these up. These are my little cards. But you can't buy any of these, because the only little cards you can buy are these. And you have to buy a little card before you buy a big poster, because this is more important than me. You know, I encourage you all to buy at least one of these. They normally sell for $10, but today they're $5 because the whole thing is going to a good cause. Something that will make Milwaukee better. When you buy my poster, it's only going to make me better. Okay? Not that I need to be better, but I'd rather see Milwaukee get better. So I encourage you to buy my poster. The other thing, I know you have to go. There is going to be a Christmas holiday sale here. If you are a student, you need to get a booth.
And alumni,
you need to get a booth. It goes back to practicing. If you want to sell your stuff, you got to practice selling your stuff. So you practice here, and you practice often. And then when you go out, you'll be more comfortable. So get a booth, practice here, make something that somebody can buy for $5, $10, $15, $20. I know that is insulting to you artists who want to be here. But, you know, if you walk home with like $100, you'll be like, yeah. Bought a $5 thing, but the next time, I only made 20 this time, the next time, you know, I'm gonna make like 20, you know, 100. Because I like, you know, because nothing is so as exciting as a big wad of money.
Andy, where are posters being sold after this talk?
On the first floor. So down on the first floor, there'll be a reception with food and water and different things, and then all the posters, including the small ones, will be sold right now.
This has been so comfortable. It's like being in our living room.